Okay, I'm ready, Nate. I'm sorry. Hello, my name is Nate.
Nate Hogan. And thank you for the cleaning up the dirty coffee anecdote this morning. That feels like home to me. But, you know, one thing you touched on was diagnostic questions about how we're growing in the fruits of the Spirit, particularly patience. And I appreciate when you've taught on that in the past, you've offered lots of diagnostic questions that I think have been helpful. One question I have is considering varying degrees of stimulus coming in, how do we evaluate that appropriately? For example, before I got married and had kids, I thought I was very patient. But now I'm four kids deep and finding out that I'm not as patient as I thought I was. So just thinking about when we look at that and say, am I more patient than I was last year? At times it's hard to determine that because maybe the stress level ramped up during that time. Is our spiritual growth meant to outpace the level of stress that's coming in, for example?
You're bringing up multiple topics here. So you're talking about measurable, the diagnostic, and now what's that one?
So if I'm looking at myself and asking myself the diagnostic question, am I more patient than I was 6 months ago, for example? Sometimes it's hard for me to think of that because during that time, Luke entered the terrible twos, let's say. So the stress level that is pushing on me is different than it was 6 months ago. So if I'm trying to see if I'm growing in that area, it's sometimes hard to determine that. So I was just wondering if you could help us think through when we look at ourselves with these questions.
You have two separate issues. So let me try, and then you can come up and ask if I go the wrong direction. But I love Nate's thought process and his seriosity. You're very serious about the Christian life. Number one, just like we know what a normal, healthy person, we're not talking about exactly, but you can tell by looking at someone whether there's something normal and healthy about them physically. There's something about their skin, there's something about their eyes, there's something about even, their proportion, whether they, if the beer belly, southern fried chicken eating, tobacco spitting person doesn't look like a paradigm example of health, I don't want to get in trouble. I pastored in the South and, they think that gluttony is a virtue, eating all you can and topping people and, the signs on I-40 of eating the 4-pound steak and it's free and they salivate and hope to be able to do that and all those things. But normal, healthy people are not supposed to compare themselves to each other. We don't go around and average, Nate is patient 7.4, but Keith is 8.1. Oh, but Esther is 9.6. So if I am 8.2 on the patient scale, look at Ephesians 4. This is what we look at every day. It says that our goal, it was just before where we were reading this morning, it says that we are supposed to be to the measure, the measure of the stature, here it is, verse 13. Ephesians 4:13. This is what we look at in the mirror. Normal, healthy looking in the mirror, we see Jesus Christ every day in the mirror of the Word. And we see him smiling at us. And we look at him and then see us. And whatever in our life is not Christ-like. See, looking in the mirror is reading the Bible. Reading the Bible, Jesus said, the scriptures speak of me. Every part of the scripture, in somehow, some way, is reflecting Christ. The Spirit of Christ was in all the prophets. That's what Peter said. The Spirit of Christ was in the Old Testament prophets. And they, Jesus said in Luke 24, were speaking of him. So every part of the Bible is somehow pointing at God in human flesh that was revealed as Jesus Christ in the New Testament. And when we look in the Bible, we see Jesus Christ, and whatever we see reflected about us that is not Christ-like, that's not Christ-like, is what we immediately ask God on a daily basis. Remember, yes, no, and okay, the texting accountability. Every day we should be asking God to make me exhibit more of Christ's personality. So look at verse 13 of Ephesians 4. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man. And here's what normal is. To the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Maturity is our goal. And so if a child is not growing, if they're failing to thrive, the doctors call it, there's failure to thrive. They're not growing. Their intestines aren't, you know, getting nutrients out. Their stomach is not working. There's something wrong. They're not maturing. They shouldn't stay little ones. Verse 14, that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery. But speaking, verse 15, the truth in love may grow up. The goal of parenting is not to perpetuate childhood. It's not to perpetuate. That's why this whole concept of much of what goes on in our society, it's almost like we have moved growing up. It's getting further and further. It's like 20-something, they're still not grown up. And there's a perpetuation of and you hear that in the church. Oh, those are just how you act in high school. That's just how you act in college. No, it's not. It's wrong. It's irresponsible. It's sinful. The goal is not to make them comfortable being children endlessly. They are supposed to be maturing. And we're supposed to be speaking, look what verse 15 says, speaking the truth in love, to help them grow up. So, Nate, I mean, pick any one of, when we see Christ, what does Christ's likeness look like? That's what the fruit of the Spirit is. So, you know, go back a book to Galatians chapter 5. And this is the metric, Galatians 5, where it says, the fruit of the Spirit, when the Spirit of God, using the Word of God, is allowed to work in my life, I will have increasing maturity. And see, the whole goal is that we mature, we no longer be children, that we grow, but we grow in grace and in the knowledge. And so what are we growing in? Love. What is love? Self-sacrifice. It should be increasingly that I don't want first place, I don't want the best, I don't want the front, I don't want the most, I don't want to be the center. I don't want everybody to. Love makes me step back and sacrifice and let others. It's when, you know, you're racing and you let off on the gas and let them go by you. You know, love makes me give, sacrifice, and be willing to take second place. That's what love does. It is not, it's a sacrificial prompting by the Lord. And that love that sacrifices finds great joy, which the Holy Spirit does, and it should be, that there is an increasing amount. The more of my life, I mean, another way that I look at it as, you know, Munger, Robert Boyd Munger, wrote a book, well, a booklet, My Heart, Christ's Home. It's a great little booklet. And what he compares the Christian life to is a house. And he said, when we get saved, my house has, this is the parsonage in Rhode Island. It had no hallways because it was so old, it was heated by fireplaces. So you had to walk through my bedroom to get to the kids' room, and you had to walk through the other kids' bedroom to get to this. And if the kids wanted to see me, they had to wake everybody up to come into our room. That's just how colonial houses were. So my house here has no hallways. It just has rooms. And Robert Boyd Munger says, when we get saved, Christ, as Paul puts it, is at home in our heart, that Christ may be at home, and that Christ in us. But we have rooms of our life that we really have not allowed him into, like our entertainment room, our recreation room, some people's finance room, some people's social life. You know, they don't want, you know, the Lord might limit that. Whatever, you can just, we're saved. Christ is at home in my heart, but I have all of Christ. Christ does not have all of me. And so that's where there are two elements going on here. The Word of God that says that we are supposed to ask for God's rule over every part of our life. And so it should be that as we grow in grace and knowledge, we say, well, Lord, I guess you can be the one that picks my movies instead of my parents, or instead of Christian, you know, movie screen it online, whatever. I would only like to be entertained by what pleases you. And so all of a sudden, my growth is that Jesus is now inhabiting my entertainment, my heart, and also what I entertain myself with. And then all of a sudden I say, wow, I'm starting to worship my recreation. And it's like, that's my time away from God and church and all that stuff. And I just want to have time to enjoy and relax and everything. And all of a sudden I say, whoa, God is supposed to be the Lord of every part of my life. And so my recreation, and all of a sudden Jesus talked about money more than anything else, and it's the monitor of my heart. So all of a sudden I say, Lord, it's not 10% or 2% or 1.34% or whatever the average is now, but God, 100% of my money belongs to you. How do you want me as your steward? And my body belongs to you, so if I'm going to recreate, how can I recreate intentionally for you? How can I try and use all of my recreation, whatever, to be a lighthouse for Christ? How can I be the best steward of my money? My social life, how can I be the fragrance of Christ online and in every social setting? You know, it's kind of the WWJD bracelet kind of life that Peter talked about, that we should follow in his steps. My social setting all of a sudden gets invaded by Christ. So the Word, you know, Matthew 6:33, seek first God's rule over every room in your house and everything else will be added. So the Word is impacting this. But also, this is where the fellowship and the accountability of the saints comes in. Because the older, if you notice what Titus 2, when I, on Jordan's question, the edification and stirring up, actually the clearest place on that is Hebrews 10. In fact, we ought to turn there because that's the theme verse of our Calvary communities. Let's look at Hebrews 10, because the way that Nate and I and anybody else will grow measurably is for people that are godly. And look what it says in Hebrews 10, 24. Let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, we are looking at people and we're seeing their lives, and it's like they think that that Christ only is here and this is off limits. And we who are further along the way say, you're supposed to allow him the lordship of your entertainment, your recreation, your money, your social life, your everything life. You know, you're supposed to be, the fellowship of the saints is supposed to lead to this edification. We're supposed to be considering one another. That's when Jesus said, consider the lilies, consider the birds of the air, consider how Solomon was arrayed. He's saying, step back and look at it and derive insights from it. We're supposed to look at other people's lives. Nate's second question was stress. There's a difference between the afflictions and trials of life, which Paul had endless ones. He says, I am pressed, I am squashed, I am buffeted, I am knocked down, I am, you know, he was squeezed in every direction. There's a difference between that and the treadmill, stress-filled lives most people lead nowadays. It's self-induced stress. It's not persecution or affliction or suffering, the normal sufferings of life. Much of our stress is this keeping up with one another. The worst thing that can happen to us is if someone says, you haven't heard? I mean, we want to be ahead, on top, in front, going, and just in everything. And so we stress. I mean, look at the kids who sleep with their phones because they don't want to miss anything. And they're missing everything that's eternal, because they don't want to miss anything that's temporal. And so what we have is people that are around us considering, and older people saying, you know what? Your family is suffering. Did you know you would do better to have a $50,000 a year job than an $80,000, or a $40,000 than a $90,000 a year job? Because you are spending so much time. You move into that better neighborhood and you've got to have better stuff, because it's embarrassing to not have better stuff in the better neighborhood when you have the better house. And you have to have the better car and the better garden and the better house. And that's back to, you know, better homes and gardens. And they say, you know what? You're only going to have your children for a very short period of time. Do you know what would be better? Why don't you live in a notch or two down and not have the pressure, so you have to take every overtime so that you can keep up and have the kids in the private school and in every athletic event, and you don't even know them, and you never are around them, and you're working endlessly, and they're going to be gone. It's kind of like, you know, I just heard a story about a family that their child, it was in my Tuesday morning Bible study, and they said that their friend was high up in Kalamazoo and their kid was good in some kind of sport, and so they sent them at age 14 to be a boarder in a sports school in Wisconsin. And they were there their 14th year, their 15th year, their 16th year, their 17th year, their 18th year, and they really got good in sports. And this person in the Bible study said they saw the parents. He said, how is Billy, or whatever the person's name was, how are they doing in that sport? And they said, oh, they quit. Now they're a dropout. They're 19. They said, we don't even know them. And the person said, do you think it was wise to send them off to excel in sports at 14? And they said, if we could go back, we would never have done that. Hebrews 10, 24 and 25 says that when you see someone that is sacrificing their family to have a better house, a better car, a better garden, a better counter, eminent, you know, it's just ugly. And they're willing to work three jobs to provide better things for their family. The best thing for their family is for them to be in the house, talking, living life, saying the nine most important words. I was wrong. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. And so that's the idea of Hebrews 10 says all of us are supposed to be open to someone saying, you know what, you're spending far too much time online, because I see you, you know, because I'm on too much. And the Lord has convicted me, and I'm praying that you will back off. You don't need to post a picture of every time your child blows their nose and every time you cut their hair. You don't need to do that. You don't need to, and you know, you are close enough that you tell them that. But what are we supposed to do? Look at verse 25. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day. See, the measure that Nate's talking about, what we're wanting is, we're wanting my life to be getting ready for the day. What's the day? The day is when I stand in front of Jesus Christ. And he's going to ask me, what did you do in your social media life that's eternal? Because he says, Menlo Park didn't ship your Facebook account up here to heaven. What did you do while you were running through the servers at Menlo Park, California, that was eternal? And how did you raise your family? Not whether or not they had the best pedigree in school and sports and clothes and house, but how much did you do what Deuteronomy 6 says, that you put Christ in front of them? You lived it out and talked to it. And how did you do showing them the lordship of Christ in your recreation and in your money and in your entertainment? Did they see consistency? And that's what we're supposed to be doing with one another. And part of how we know we're making progress is godly people that are further down the road that have walked long with Christ are coming to us and saying, you know what? I admire what I see you doing in your family, because I struggled with that. Or I appreciate the sacrifices you're making. I see. And I could talk about that. I see some of the young men in the church doing things that I never did at their age with my children. And I look at them and I say, oh, keep it up. And I pray you keep doing that. So, Nate, let's go back. I don't think I answered Nate's question, but he gave me a great T-ball thing to say a lot of stuff I wanted to say for a long time. But what Nate asked about is, how do we evaluate the fruit of the Spirit? We evaluate it from Galatians 5, and not only the raw scripture, but godly people that we know that appear to be patient and kind and self-controlled and everything. We open our lives up. That's where this whole accountability and small group and stirring one another is almost, I mean, we spout Bible knowledge, but we don't practice this edifying and stirring one another. And stress, much of it, is self-induced.